मॉडल आंसर जो कि क्वेश्चन नंबर 15 है उनका ही राइट कर क्वेश्चन नंबर 2006 दिसंबर बाद
रोड से ना रनिंग आउट ऑफ एल्टीट्यूड
ఇదే అంతిమ రోడ్ ప్రాబ్లమ్ రోడ్
కింద ప్రాబ్లమ్
రన్నింగ్ అవుట్ ఆఫ్ అడ్రస్ స్పేస్ అడ్రస్ ఇదే మళ్ళీ దేన్ని అడ్రస్
We have finished very well this time. I think this timing is okay. So this keyword, if you can put in this samaya in your answer, it's good. Shall we read one or two? Fifteen for the reason. We have to do real lesson removes the class boundary. Problem in the classical addressing method. Is that we can divide the IP address at any point to separate the next ID and the host ID portion. This gives the flexibility to create subnets at almost any size. Therefore, the address space can be efficiently utilized when in classful method. VLSN can be used as a temporary solution for the load problem till the deployment of IPv6. Yeah, I think that's a good answer. Captures the key point. When we say almost any size, we can get almost any size. With VLSN, till 2 to the power. These subnets should be having a maximum of 2 to the power n computers, where n can be of any value. any integer. You can have a subnet which is in 5 computer. So this is a notion that when you do almost any size, you can mention 2 to the power n addresses where n can be any integer. Figure a kind of thing, if you can draw a figure of this very good. Like subnet mask will be 13 points, so on. So many bits to this side, so many bits to the other side. Something like that, if you can show that. Of course, that's not compulsory, that is not an answer. You can illustrate with a figure, that's good. Explaining a total power in what will be easier to do. On the right you can count into the number of people. Remaining bits you can put 1. Make sure there are n zeros here, therefore 2 to the power n addresses are available within the subnet mask. Something like that with a figure is not easy to explain. one thing I noticed in his answer is that he has mentioned flexibility, that's good. If you can illustrate it with one example, it's good. To say an organization may have a need of different size, network, sub-networks of different sizes depending on the number of employees. See? So that is what we mean by flexibility. You could explain like that, good. But otherwise, even since you have the word flexibility, it's good. It means the same thing. But if you just say that it is be careful about the spelling and the grammar, right? And this time they are serious in that. So, in the advanced diploma, extremely serious. Diploma, they might. Even diploma now, they have clear indicators for that, so they have to not be. So, this year, diploma, I am getting the answers from the students, they are correcting in the spelling. This I could not do for, I think, you know that. We were studying here. So this year I am doing it because I have indicated I think those rules are coming from the CEO. That institute is putting some rules. Any other answer you would like to show me? Okay. If you are sure about the answer, don't show me other answer. Not sure, if you are not sure, we don't show it, then I might be able to we'll give more to part B. The small company has a class C IP address of 201.45.222.0/24. Three subnets are required within this address. Using VLSM, determine the subnet addresses required for each of these. So three subnets, S1, S2 and S3. S1 10 Hz, S2 50 Hz, S3 100 Hz. So you can prepare something like a table. So already the address has, it's a class C, so class 24. Then S1 is 10. Go for the 2 to the power n value which is higher than 10, which will be 16. So it has to be 4 there for that subnet. 4 bits you will have to remove. Here the right hand side will be 4, left hand side will be 5. So imagine you are all your writing. How to write this? Think before you write, don't just write everything. Think about how best to present this. Because you have basically 6 marks there, nearly 10 to 12 minutes are available. So, no harm spending 1 or 2 minutes to think of how to present. Think of, can I draw a diagram first? Likewise, you have to think. Is the diagram Thank you. baby was okay. After you decide the subnet number, then decide the, they say determine the subnet addresses request for each of the three subnets.
And the age of
range of first, and the first second line is there. So the first first will be 2.01. The first and the last. First is there. That is 2.45, that is 2.1. That is 2.45. That is 2.1. That is last step. Suppose it can go to 15. So all of them are 1, 1, 1, 1. Is that we have reserved last 24. Minimum and maximum for time losses available is up to 40. Then the 4 bits become all 0, which is an error. First first will be 0001. Last first will be 1111. Sorry, not last first, broadcast 1111. So 1110 is the last, this will be 14. 8 plus 4 plus 14. Likewise you can do for the step.
Yeah, we have reserved in 50.
sample calculations we can show in addition to this, but otherwise find the presentation technique like this so that he will see the full picture here. After he, you will also see now even the 16 is he, he will see because he we can just double check whether the end of that is the start of the next one. So everything is together, double checking is easy. In the exam, you yourself can see it. It is perfect. Question 2, part B is that I suggest you refer to the internet further only. Question 2, part B, a moment ago we discussed. Explain the use of request for comment in developing the standard. Do an internet search as well, but in general, what is the in developing standard, question 3 marks, that means you can spend about 4 to 5 minutes. 5 minutes later. So you must explain that procedure of developing SAND. Three stage procedure. Draft, then RFC, then internet SAND. And also mention the keyword IETF. There are people doing it. And draft 6 months. Then RFC. Then you allow sufficient time for the comments. Include the comments and finalize the SAND. So explain that and mention RFC is the middle stage. And the main idea of RSC is to get the expert group to study further and send their comments. Initial one, the draft is for everybody. You just publish it anywhere in the internet. But RSC is you send to identify special groups who are really academically studying these things. So you get expert comments in the RSC. So for that, can you do a internet search? So that's how those questions come. You can see the last thing we discussed is about standards. Now this question to part B is asking only little part of that. Okay. Part C also can be asked answer, question 2. So is answer part B clear? The way you have to present? You have to present with a diagram the 3-step process. And then explain about this middle step. What is the purpose of it? Because they say how to use the RSC in developing the standard. So you have to say the purpose is to get the comments from the expert group. Before finalizing, it has a standard. That's the purpose. Organize the answer clearly like that. I think there again a diagram would be very, very helpful to show the flow. Don't miss to mention IETF. They are the people doing it. And if you have time, you can mention about the ISOC. IETF is also an organization of ISOC. And they are the people who make use of the RFC. And if you have time to highlight the answer further, give a one RFC number for a particular protocol that we study. And then say this is an example of a procedure developing up to a full protocol. There is another one to mention there. When you say RFC, how it is updated, you have to mention. The purpose of the RFC is it will be superseded by another number. Suppose you have RFC 1213, later on they will say RFC 1254 is superseding 1230. May not be 1240. 1240 might have been allocated to something else now. So later they may say, okay, RFC 1213 is now updated. RFC 1284 is the new stack. So then one becomes inactive, other one becomes active stack. I think it's better to mention that also, the updating procedure of RFC. If it is a new currency, if there is a new standard, it is approved. You will replace the previous RFC, make it inactive, and make the new one active standard. But all these inactive standards are also there in the internet. If you refer to IETF, they have all that to be accepted. Problem is they have been made inactive by subsequent RFC. So you must send that also in the and then it is fully complete. Why don't you read the Wikipedia or any definition of RFC and they will give this super field advanced picture. One good example is RIP version 1, RIP version 2 are different RFC. Some other years they are asking you what are the differences between RIP version 1 and RIP version 2. I think it's better for you to remember those RFC numbers, although it's not mandatory, because that question comes very often. Worth of remembering. And then that can answer this also. You can say, okay, RIP version 1 is this RFC, version 2 is this RFC, so version 2 is superseding the version 1. Then they can be very convinced that you are following this RFC procedure. So I would suggest that you, especially this RIP version 1 version 2 now, as I got remembered, you should remember, at least up to the extent. To make to the examiner convinced that you are following these numbers and updating procedures. In the note, I would have given the RFC numbers. I don't know. Anyone remember? Can we refer to the note? It should be under what topic? Network Connect. It is diploma. Diploma.
NMP.
NMP. You need it as the diploma.
11 not something.
No, 11 not taken by means basic. It is not RFC also, it is IEC. Thank you. I suggested some of these which are very open, like RIT or SNNC, to try to remember it to them. Only the previous night you can do it. Next night you can do it. We are doing a little trick.
To convince the examiner that you are very thorough there. Thorough about it. Eccentric. So most of the time the examiners will not remember it, so therefore they will think you are marvelous because you even remember that. That's how they give marks.
Write down these five. It was saying Anandi, I'm not sure whether I gave it in or not. Yes, RIP version 1, version 2, which is not.
It's reference to international standards, recommendations and regulatory authorities state the body that is responsible for number one, developing international standards for data form. Number two, the preparation and publishing of international standards for all electrical, electronic and related technology.
how they check whether you have visited the website. They are asking, they don't give the name of the organization, they give the activity. They want you to name the organization. So ask for number one, that will be there. Team 1. If you are looking international, then ask for data for them. ISO is okay, for a framework, yes, ISO, but integration, ISO is not doing anything. For data form, what is the most commonly used, common organized? The protocol we have inside, mostly coming from. October the coordinates is the moment of ITCOM. Most data comes to occur is according to the ITCOM. You can mention both, you can mention ISO for developing logical facts. But ISO does not develop any practical facts. Then ITCOM, you will give it as an example, it develops implementation of facts. Not logical framework, but implementation framework. Give the example like 802.3, 802.5, 802.11, like that. Then the preparation and publishing of international standards for all electrical, electronics and related technologies. Preparation and publishing of international standards. IEEE does it, but it is not the main job. It is preparation and publishing of international standards. Cool. ETS type. It is only for standardized, nothing else. It's not association of professionals. Directly standardizing body by the government. ETSI is the main answer for that. You can mention IEEE is also doing it, but IEEE is an association of professionals. ETSI is not an association of professionals, it's a government body by the European Union. They have appointed ETSI only for standardized. So therefore, more proper answer is ETSI. Okay, so about the standards, questions will be like this. Sometimes they give the organization and then ask what they are doing. Sometimes they give the description of what they are doing and ask what is the most fitting organization for this district. And you will notice that this sentence may be directly taken from their website. Most of the time they just cut and paste the sentence in the main page of the website.
Other two fields within the criteria of this one for defining this
December 2006. Normally when you ask for the certificate, it does not come like this. the format is this, but they extract the fields from that and put it into a nice format and then show it to you. But if you know that, okay, these are the places that these organizations exist, and the third party also certifying their address, then you can be fairly sure. But there are other places like PayPal which take more responsibility. You can pay through the PayPal and then you can have a claim. PayPal might refund it. But last one I was saying was direct. Direct payments are very risky. Because there is no intermediate company to monitor the payment. But companies like PayPal, they are in this field. So you pay to PayPal, PayPal will release the money when you confirm that you received the goods. So if you don't receive the goods, it has happened to me also once. I didn't expect the books I ordered, so I didn't get the books I ordered. Then I just wrote to PayPal, I paid to you, but the books did not come. And PayPal has informed that to the other party, which is registered under PayPal, and they have sent me a new set of two books actually. They shipped it to me again. And little time later I got the original two again. So it was in the customs or somewhere. So I received two packs. But there were no complaints actually. They were so reliable that they shipped it again. Because this intermediate company PayPal is very strong. And if they blacklist the other company, they lose a lot of business. So the other company don't want to do that, and they, even though they had shipped it there, they made no fuss and they shipped again. Because their name is more important to them in the internet than Tobo. You can see the way the internet business pattern. So if you are paying through such a company, then it is more reliable. But if you are paying direct, you definitely have to look for these things in the certificate. Because you are not sure whether this server you are communicating is a genuine server or someone else trying to do phishing of your information. So I think issuer's name, issuer's address, then expiry date, that kind of things are the more important fields for the user. You can mention 2-3 of them. Why don't you go to some eBay or PayPal or somewhere, at the bottom there is this icon, just click on that and say you want to use it, then verify is another verified one, something similar to verify, but I have never heard of. So then you can log on to that and say I want to leave your certificate, then that certificate is active. If you do that, then you will see this scale, how they come to the customer screen. So any two things should be okay for that. But there again, I would like you to try this before you answer the paper. Right? You don't need to enter your credit card details, right? You just say, okay, I want to see your certificate. Right? Any valid server should have a certificate. Sometimes when you access some servers, if security is enabled in your computer, it will come up with a message, okay, this server is not certified, do you want to view the certificate? Have you seen that picture? Then you can click view. At the bottom there is a simple point called view. When you click on that, it gets a copy of the security certificate from that website, from that server, and put it onto the screen for you to view. If you are not sure about that, you can go and verify the issuer's security certificate. Who has issued it? That's also there. Okay. And for example, I don't have the connection today. If I am logging to Maroto University, our department website server, you usually get a error message saying, okay, are you sure about this server? I have to say, I am sure, it's my server. The reason is that we have fairly outdated secret certificate. We have not updated it because we have to pay. So we have got it there, and after that we have not renewed. Older one is continuously passed to all people who are. If you have enabled the security here, this computer is asking the server, who are you? Then server gives that older certificate. Then this computer tells me, I am not sure about this, this is expired. Are you sure? He is asking me. Then I have to say, I am okay, accept it. Then that is the website offer. So experience things like that, then it is not it. Shall I give a... Therefore, you will not be able to see. When I am logging on to my email, I will check that. So, you can check that with that one. In the demilitarized zone, that means the part which is already open, there will be no questions asked you. But whenever you enter the password, only this problem happens. The computer might tell you, this is expired security certificate. Should I accept? If you click accept only, it will website will open, otherwise it will not be open. So anyway, these things are common experience, so please try before this time. X509 at work, you can see for yourself. Okay, by next time tell me here. Write down the answers. Now he has written answers, I can see. So, we will write answers by next time. And discuss the written answers next time to check whether any keywords are missing, whether the presentation is proper. Now even this network kind of thing, you can have variety of presentation. This is only one way. There may be a lot of other ways you can present your answer. Or else, same answer you can write just one and the other, it might run out to 2-3 pages. Then the examiner will have to turn your pages to find out where these things are. He would not like it. So normally when you are writing on the page, on the answer sheet, if you have written part of a question up to the bottom of the first page, one page, and suppose you have a little part left to go to the other page, it refers to a diagram or something in this page. It's always better to leave the remaining part blank and start the diagram next page. So the diagram and the answer using the diagram can be in one page for the exam. Those are again tricks in the sense you make it easier for the examiner. Then he normally will mark, he knows that you are better off. Sometimes we have some space here, we don't want to leave there. We want to blow the table there and then start answering, continuing the answer next day. You don't need to do that. You can leave any amount blank. The only requirement is, it must be easy for the examiner to read. So leave space, it's okay. Right? Think of, when you are writing the answer that one, think of the presentation style. Once you try several of them, then you will automatically have that knack. Okay, this must be the way I should present for this type of thing. That comes to experience also. Tell me, I have written answers by next time. And rather than writing answers again, which is already there, you know, I think what we should do is to discuss the content of answers you wrote and see how good they are, how fitting they are. I have to give the same note again. As written, which is the no point. Right? Any other difficult point? Be very sensitive to these types of questions, right? They look very easy when you look at. When you look at the question, you will find, okay, I have done this. Even in the diploma, I have done this. You might get that feeling. But be extra careful, it is not like that. Extra careful because it is not the knowledge sometimes they are looking for, it's the presentation style.
Administration unit and AU pointer is separately have this type.
Okay, AU and AU pointer in STM1. What are the functions of AU and AU pointer? It's like this. When you when you take the administrative unit, there are three. Did I show you a table? How many administrative units are there? I'll open it.
Unloading.
you are loading things onto the STL, you must inform how to unload. Then only the administrative part is covered. Otherwise, if your pointer is not there, how can someone unload it? That's why the name administrative unit.
So practically again, you can make a buffer run of the yard and again.
This is the base, last 3 bytes we are not using for point, you may remember. These 3 bytes are for justification, the clock variable. These 7 bytes, the 6 bytes, is for the pointer. It is in the 4th row, not 3rd row. First 3 rows are for the header. 4th row, first 6 bytes, is the AU for pointer. This highlighted one is the pointer. Okay. And then DC4 could start anywhere, maybe starting here, and then starting at the 6th, you are writing here.
So make it the මෙතනින් දැන් එනකොට මේ ටික ලෝඩ් වෙලා දැන් මේකත් ලෝඩ් වෙලා නේ ඊට පස්සේ මෙහෙම රෝස් නේ මේ වැදිනවා. මෙහෙම යනකොට දැන් මේ ටික බෆ වෙලා ඊළඟ හතරෙන් රෝ එකේ මේක ආපු ගම තමයි මෙයාව ගන්න මෙතන තිබුණා.
Yes, this is all buffered before now. This is prepared before you attack. This pointer you are adding in this place is not added while you are attacking. It's a place. This point, suppose you loaded DC4 from here, you add that, and after that then you start transmitting from here. So your question is, while you are transmitting, how do you know whether your pointer is here? How do we know that whether it started there? That's not the case. All these points are prepared in the memory. It is only 2700 bytes or something. It's in the memory, and after that, after preparing everything, you start transmitting. By that time the point is ready. All the administrative functions have to be done before you transfer. Okay. For example, you can give some parcel to say CGR or somewhere to transfer to unwrap. Okay. It is only a virtual container you give. How can that become an administrative unit for CGR? They have to attach a serial number or some label with some number or something to identify you and the place to download it. Till then, it is not properly administered, isn't it? Anything can go wrong. The administrative unit means that you are now ready to, you have identified where to unload it and you know how to unload it. That's why the name administrative. Till then, what you handed over is yours. They have not really identified where it is to be unloaded. Same idea here. Remember, there are lots of traffic going in STM1. Many people's traffic. Various types, audio, video, data, everything is going. So, unless you exactly know where these things are starting and what is there in the container, you run into a lot of problems in unload. It is like a ship arrives in the Colombo port. And only one container to be downloaded to the Colombo port, and it is at the bottom of this. And there are thousands of containers on top. How do you unload? How do you do that? Who administers? Because you have to unload all them. One ship might carry thousands of containers. One by one, you have to unload everything. The last one is for Colombo. And you unload it and check everything again. That might take 1 week. And then leave, but only one container to be unloaded. Is that the way to do? No? The one to be unloaded in Colombo, it should be slowly. Now, every time you put new containers, you take that out, put the new containers, take this on. That's how they organize. Those are administrative processes. You think of unloading, when you unload, you can't just put everything. Okay? Because unloading is to be done very quick. Otherwise the ship will be here for 1 week and the payment will be huge. If the ship is to use the port for 1 week, they have to pay. And they will have to charge it from their account. Same thing happens. If DH is backbone, variety of traffic of many people are going, any particular person's traffic you must be immediately able to remove without taking anybody else's traffic. That's the idea of SDH. it's a complicated word because SDH is out of all protocols, SDH is the most complex. Because it is in the physical layer. When it comes goes to the physical layer, any top layer in the hierarchy, all of them are putting the data onto the physical layer. Physical layer is the one carrying the biggest burden. That's why in the syllabuses you are not asked to study the header of SDH. You see the IP header. The 20 byte IP header is easy to study. But look at the SDH, I'll just show you how complicated it is. This is the SDH header, this is the path overhead. Path overhead, and all these bytes are header. This is the section of the text, multiple section. Let us look at these bytes. These are the descriptions of size. Description of all the headers. They don't want you to family, therefore they did not include any syllabus. Syrian is really good. This is the header. This is section overhead only. SOS. There was RSOS, MSOS, PASSOS. Three types of overhead. This is only RSOS. This part, multiple section of NTS. Each byte has bit, each bit has a restriction. See the complexity of critical name? But people know that you know critical name. Anybody could do it. Physical name is more difficult. And therefore many textbooks do not describe physical layer. They describe something like IP, which is very easy to understand for everybody. Describe what is IP. IP is actually the easiest to understand. That's why they always talk about IP. People don't talk about SDH. Actually, they don't even mention the name. They don't even mention the name because they are afraid of it. Who wants to study all this? These are the description of bits, bytes. These are byte names like A1, frame, B1, B2, parity check, C1. And so all the bytes. Like A1. It's complicated. Much more complicated than layer 3. So in your syllabuses, layer 3 and layer 2 were there. But SDS, we study only the concept, but not the header in detail. Why do we need this method for detailed header? Because of Android. So that without checking any neighbor's byte, a particular user's traffic you can directly Android. Otherwise, you can check it. And that happens while the frame is playing. So therefore, SDS is the most carefully designed protocol. Very popular, most carefully designed. Understand the purpose, then you will find the bytes before computation. Otherwise, out of this 2700 bytes, how many bytes are used in the header? 91. Excuse me. Bytes. 81 bytes used for the header, passed away another 9 bytes, so what will be the 90 byte header? IP has only 20 bytes header. 20 bytes header for 65,000 bytes long packet. So this is 90 bytes header for 2,800 bytes header. Heavy header, isn't it? Big header. Such a big header is there because unloading has to be thought of. IP has never thought of unloading. Because it's only logical organization. So there is no problem like unloading for that. It's a question. We'll stop there today. Next time please come with the written down answer. And use your best presentation style you like, right? Best. And we will next time see whether it is a book. If not, we will discuss and see how to improve. And remember, the physical layer is the most difficult to study. Therefore, our solution is not to study.